Chapter 38. I've gone numb. Everything's blank. It's like someone reached inside my head and pulled out the part of my brain that feels things. If someone pointed a gun at me now, I'd just look down the barrel, my eyes glazed, and wait for the bullet to come. I don't care about nothing, not even staying alive. JJ's gone. Even those words don't soak into my brain. He died in hospital yesterday afternoon. I was there when he died, but they wouldn't let me in the room. They tried their best, but he lost too much blood. Shanked 11 times. His chest and arms ripped open by a kitchen knife. They told me more. Something about his ribcage. But I didn't listen. It don't make no difference how he died. I stare through the windscreen at the dark grey sky, clocking movement on the street to my right, but not bothering to move my eyes. Miss Murfield's hand slides on top of mine in my lap. It's cold and clammy, and the ring scratches my knuckle, but I don't move. Feels like I'm frozen to the spot. My mind's empty. That's how I want it. It's like I need to keep it blank, like the rest of me. Thoughts of JJ try and creep into my head, but I push them out, sweeping it all clean. I can't deal with it. I just want to think about nothing. I close my eyes. Unwanted thoughts leaking into my mind. It's like JJ said, you can't think about nothing. You just can't. When we was little, we used to play a game where we'd guess what each other was thinking. Sometimes I'd say nothing, and JJ would call me a liar. Turns out, I was lying. You can't empty your head completely, because as soon as you get rid of one thing, something else slides in. I shove these thoughts out, and sure enough, something else creeps in, triggered by the rustle of Miss Murfield's clothes as she twists in her seat. I keep my eyes fixed straight ahead, letting my mind linger on Miss Murfield because it's better than the other options. She's talking to me now, her words coming out in a soft whisper like a radio turned right down. I just keep staring at the sky, my brain tuning in and out. Don't want to talk, just wanted to say, in case I don't get a chance to. I can't even tell what I'm staring at. Maybe it's atoms in the air. Feels like I ain't blinked in years. Miss Murfield's words roll around in my head like bits of old rubble. Spend time, young offenders, stay strong. Miss Murfield leans over and I find myself turning on automatic just as the last words slip out of her mouth. But believe me, it will get better. Miss Murfield looks like she's holding back tears. Her eyes is all watery and her lips wobbling, but through the wetness, her eyes look firm. They're focused on me. I just look at her blankly. Somewhere at the back of my mind, I'm taking in the words and thinking, how do you know? But then the thought floats away again. I keep staring. Miss Murfield stares back, not blinking, even though her eyes is filled with tears. This goes on for long. Then finally Miss Murfield lifts up her free hand and pokes at the corner of one eye. She mops up the tears that spill out. Then she does the same for the other eye. Sorry, she says, proper tears running down her cheeks. She's crying now, blubbing like a baby. I'm so sorry. I'm supposed to be staying strong for you, and look at me. She moves her hand off mine and rummages for a tissue. I just watch, feeling like I'm seeing it on TV. Like it don't really matter what happens because it ain't real anyway. When she finishes wiping and blowing, she looks at me again, her face blotchy but calm. My dad died, she says. I was 15. Same as you. I blink. For the first time since JJ died, something cuts through the blankness. I didn't know, I find myself saying. My brain suddenly flooding with thoughts. Her dad died. And her mum. That means she ain't got no one. That means when Miss Murfield was 15, she lost the one person who was close in her life. Like me. My eyes clock the movement of her fingers in her lap and I work something out. Did he give you that, miss? She nods. A sad smile forming on her lips as she looks at the ring. We sit like this for long. Both of us staring at the ring. No one talking. I want to feel numb. Just push out all the thoughts from my head like before. But I can't stop them coming in. It's like they're flowing too fast and my barriers ain't strong enough to keep them out. I got it all wrong. Miss Murfield didn't have no perfect family or upbringing. I've been thinking she was one of them who grew up cushioned with support from her blood fam. Kind words every day, peas on tap, a noisy house full of laughter and voices. I seen that place she lived in with Mr. Slick and Big Tits and I thought, rah, she's got it all worked out. She ain't got no troubles in her life. But I was wrong. It's like I need to rewind my brain. Rethink everything I ever thought about Miss Murfield. My eyes travel up to her face and I see she ain't crying no more. She's just staring at the ring, looking sad. That's how she knows, I think to myself. That's how she knows what it's like to be all on your own. Just you against the rest of the world. That's how she knows what it's like to be pushed around and told what to do and how to act when all you want to do is curl up and cry. Her words drift back to me from before. It will get better. I want to believe her. I want to trust Miss Murfield and look out for this crack of light in this blackness, but I can't. It ain't there. JJ's gone. Things ain't never going to be good again. Miss Murfield's wrong about that. It feels as if you'll never get through it, says Miss Murfield quietly, like she can see into my brain. But you will. I shake my head slowly. I'll help you, she says, meeting my eye and rolling her lips together like she's going to cry again. Like Mr. Jacobs helped me. The words hit me with a jolt. Mr. Jacobs, her piano teacher. Suddenly I get why Miss Murfield's here. Why she done all that stuff for me. I get why she gives me fresh threads in the morning to make me look smart. Why she stuck up for me against Mr. Pritchard. Why she kept calling and pinging to check I was okay and giving me tea and telling me to change my lifestyle, get a job, get away from the crew. I turn and look out the window, feeling the curtain come down again as my head fills with black thoughts. I focus on pushing them out, emptying my head, letting the blankness take over again. Minutes later, I hear Miss Murfield shifting next to me, checking her watch and sucking in a deep breath of air like she's gearing up for something. I'm running out of time. I know, I say, before she says it. I gotta go. She nods and grabs my hand and gives it a little squeeze. I look at her wet brown eyes, try and give her a look that says, thanks. Then I undo the seatbelt and slide out onto the road, looking up at the white stone building that's about to swallow me up. A thought slips into my mind that this might be the last time I stand out on the street for how many months. But then it slips out again without leaving no trace. I don't feel scared or nervous. I don't even feel angry. I just feel blank. The blankness carries on through the trial. I get put on this bench behind the plastic scene and I sit staring out at the wood-panelled room while people in wigs use words like callous and unrepentant and premeditated. They're talking about me, but I don't even feel a flicker inside me. I don't care. The woman defending me comes back with words like disadvantaged and vulnerable and does this long speech about how I was let down by this and that. But in the end, all the words don't count for nothing and I'm sentenced to 3 months inside, just like everyone else. I get up from the hard wooden bench, cuffs clicking tight round my wrists like they did round JJ's 2 days ago. I look straight ahead, pushing thoughts of JJ's tattooed skin from my mind and avoiding Miss Murfield's eye as I marched out the room. If this was a week ago, I think to myself, I'd be lashing out and cussing at the guard whose hand wrapped too tight round my arm. Maybe I'd be shaking with nerves or crying on account of what's going to happen to me next. But it feels like that was a different girl. That was a girl who had things to live for in the outside world. Right now, cuffs and uniforms and swipe card doors ain't going to make no difference to my life. Right now, I just don't care.